ask a few questions, which I hope the panel will answer. Investing in influencers, irrespective of the medium, is it key to a brand? How can broadcasters, publishers, use the influencers they have to build their communities and marry them with brands to have that multiplier factor? How do you deliver the right video for the various platforms? Should it be a long-running series or a short one-off film? Is it one size that fits all? I'd like to invite the panel. Gurpreet Singh, COO and co-founder, One Digital Entertainment. Applause, please. Thank you. Naushad Rizwanullah, CEO, Miss Malini. Shrenik Gandhi, CEO and co-founder, White River Media. Gaurav Lula, COO, Loose Cannon Studio. Prajakta Kohli, web influencer. And the panel will be moderated by Ambi Parmeswaran, brandbuilding.com, ex-CEO, FCB, Ulka. Welcome.
Hello. All of you well fed? Ready to sleep? So we'll try and keep you awake. So one, thank you, Anil and IndianTelevision.com for inviting me to chair this panel. I feel like truly like a fossil sitting amongst these, you know, five people of the modern era. I learned my ropes in advertising in 1978. In fact, the first thing I did was a summer assignment, which was summer project, which was on simulation model for media planning. And I've been brought up on a regular diet of regular media planning, which is we used to have reach, OTS, impact, threshold, stuff like that. I'm told all that is gone now. We used to have a old saying, which is attributed to two different people, Lord Leverhulme of Lever Brothers and John Wanamaker across the Atlantic, who said 50% of my advertising is wasted. I don't know which half. Today, I think the truth, today when I talk to people who are investing money in digital media, there's an interesting corollary to that statement that which I'm going to provoke the panel to try and answer, which is that 90% of digital advertising money is wasted. But you don't know which 10% is working. So you don't know what to cut, what to keep. So let me start, and I think each of you can, go through this, and we'll start with Gaurav, right? So Gaurav, for the sake of the assembled audience here, if you can speak for about a few minutes on what you think is the role of influencer marketing in building brands, and from your own archives, do you have any example which has been very good, a good case study sorts? And also, how do you measure the effectiveness of influencer marketing?
Right. Thanks, everyone. Thank you, MB. I think from where I see it, the biggest advantage of influencer marketing is the ability to humanize the brand. There is a very clear way of making that brand speak and sound like a person without having to give away a lot of your brand attributes. And with that comes the challenge of influencer marketing, if you ask me, which is, unfortunately, it's looked upon as a way to create reach, which is, in today's day and age, in the digital world, a paid expense. Algorithms work against you. Platforms are ensuring that branded content is seen lesser and lesser, and maybe rightly so, on consumers' timelines. And these same consumers of your brand are also fans of these entities that you want to partner with. My biggest sort of filter when you see that success or failure of influencer marketing is how involved is the influencer in your message? Is it just a regular shout out? Is it just a regular video shot to camera? Or is the influencer actually taking your brand to the next level more through their lens than the brand lens? And I think that's where this beautiful balance between influencer and brand sort of comes alive. We've seen a lot of influencer activities in the past, and I would love to hear from the other panelists, but I feel it's come to a stage where it's become a tick mark. It's become a checkbox saying, in my campaign, off social media with respect to this brand's launch. Here's a bunch of influencers who spoke about us. What they said, did it matter? Did you even bother reading what the comments were below this? None of that matters. And that's, I think, where this will become a problem as we go forward with respect to influencer marketing. I think with respect to examples of what we do well, I think a lot of influencer management companies, companies that manage a lot of influencers, are learning the ropes and trying to educate their partners, and I think Gurpreet will be able to add more on that, on how do we make this a happy marriage and not a one-night stand. And I think the more we do that, the more those influencers will start bringing recall to brands instead of it the other way around, where you have a large bunch of people saying things that nobody wants to listen to. So I think that's my perspective on influencer marketing.
Yeah, thank you. You didn't tell us any standout case which you think has done a great job with influencer marketing.
I think there is a bunch of stuff that we've seen before.
You want to play it safe?
No, I don't want to. I'm good with saying good and bad both. But I think Tubok does an interesting job with how they do influencer marketing. I think Bacardi Breezer, and I think you'll hear more about it from the One Digital Universe, they do an interesting job of how do you do influencer marketing. The problem with this industry is because it's so new as a concept, there aren't any standout cases which check all boxes. And I think that's a learning curve for all of us. Having said that, there are a lot of bad examples of how influencer marketing shouldn't be done.
Okay, good. So thank you. So we move to Gurpreet, yeah. Right? Yeah, now tell us.
I think Gaurav has summed it pretty well. We come from an influencer side. We work with influencers. We work with brands. And I think the challenge right now is more in convincing brands, but I think it's a learning phase also. It's not something which we have been doing or the brands have been doing since last decade or so. This is something which has just come up in last few years. So the challenge right now for us is to convince brands that this is the right thing to do. I won't say brands don't get it. A lot of new age brands, they have started getting it. In fact, we try to do more collaborative brainstorm sessions, getting the influencers involved so that brands get to know what they mean, because if they're trying to reach out to their fan base, to the influencers' fan base, and no one knows their fan base more than influencers. So even if you're trying to force fit your brand, an influencer will be able to tell you if this will work for you or not. And they want it to work. This is a full-time career for them. They also want the brand to get results. They are not in that business, ki aaj, let's do this deal, let's make some money out there. I don't care if it works for the brand or not. It's in their interest to ensure that it works for the brand. So I think the more the brands will be ready to collaborate with influencers rather than just coming up with a checklist that they want this logo, this kind of placement in their video, I think the more they will be able to collaborate better the results will be. And a lot of people have started seeing those examples.
Any good standout example which you can think of? I'm doing it because, you know, I don't know about you. I'm trying to learn. So
can I?
I'm making notes here.
Can I refer to one of the case studies
we
did?
Yeah, please do. Please do.
So when Nokia last year, they were doing their relaunch campaign in India, we reached out to Nokia. You know that Nokia is famous for their signature tune, the tune that they had on Nokia 3310. And so we said, you know what, let's recreate this tune in today's day, with today's music. And we'll get, because Nokia also wanted some legendary names to come and do it, rather than just youngsters out there. So we got Ehsaan and Loy to come on board and recreate that tune. But we knew that while they are big celebrity stars, but possibly their day-to-day engagement with the young audiences is not way too high. So we got people
They belong to my generation, probably.
but
being polite.
But I think what we did.
So Shankar is much younger, I think.
Sorry?
Shankar probably is much younger.
Yeah. So what we did, we got people like Darshan Rawal, Shirley Setia, DJ Chetas, Aditi Singh Sharma. So they created their own versions of that tune and said, this is my own style of the Nokia tune, and I'm sending it to Ehsaan and Loy. Why don't you guys submit your own tunes and send it to them? And they will then create a new track, which is more of a UGC generated track which they'll plug in all the entries which they will receive. And I think that gave Nokia a large set of response. I honestly don't think if it was pure SAN and Loya, they would have got this number of entries.
Great. So this, you know, using mobile tunes is a great way of engaging with at least, I think, I remember when we were handling Tata Docomo, they actually opened up the tune and got people to interpret the tune. I think several thousand musicians around the country participated in that contest. So that's a great idea. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
Yep, thanks. So, Prajakta, tell us how you pick brands.
Is this what? Okay.
Or do they pick you?
It's actually 50-50, I think. We also reach out to brands. Brands reach out to us all the time because we all work in the same ecosystem. But I think whether or not a brand deal goes through depends on a couple of things that we always have in mind. I feel like the monies and everything comes in much later because that's the smart guys take care of it. I feel like first we look at if the brand is a fit with the content. It's very important that there is a way we can figure out if we can make this brand fit very easily into it, where it does not look like a very in-your-face sort of a advertisement, or I or the channel does not end up looking like a sellout. So it's very important to, because you know the audience that consumes a lot of digital content is super smart.
So have you noticed that when you plug a brand which is kind of disconnected with your content, there is a dropout? Have you tested it out?
I mean, yes. We luckily not on a very large scale, but on a smaller scale, we did try a couple of products that didn't quite work that well with us, where we got a lot of backlash, the brand got a lot of backlash, which is where I think Gurpreet says that, you know, it's very important for the creator and the brand to sort of meet halfway, because we get the audience, we know the audience, and the brand knows the brand. So I think that can be a good collaboration. And the audience always picks up, you know, matlab ye wala koi hisab nahi hota ki, oh, I'll like slyly act like, oh, hey guys, don't mind me, just using Tide. You know, you try to do it like that, and if you think that the audience is not going to get it, it's really stupid.
But you know, and everybody just gets to interrupt, and since Anil is here, he wants me to get into my professor mode once in a while, right? So what is the color of the dress Santa Claus wears? Red, right? Red.
Yeah.
Okay, he wears red. Who made Santa Claus dress red? Coca-Cola. Right? So that was the original, probably, placement. Right? Did you know that?
No, I didn't know.
Good show. Now continue. Yeah.
So, yeah, I think that's how, if or not, I can get the brand to sort of mix well with the content, is if we are going forward with it or not. That's how we pick brands.
So in your opinion, I mean, you don't want to talk about, maybe you don't want to talk about your own brands, but which is one influencer marketing stuff which a brand has done which you think is really good? So stay out of your own work if you think that's embarrassing, or if you think something you've done has really been great joy to work with and it also did wonders for the brand. Can you give one or two?
I think if you have to talk about like a mass influencer campaign, I think what Google has been doing with Pixel is genius. Where Google has always been treating all of us creators really, really well. We wait for those Google mails all the time. But they give away the phones, which are pretty kick-ass.
That's nothing, yeah.
Yeah, but also they give it away without...
It works for the brand.
Yeah, it works because they don't give it saying, hey, you know what, why don't you make a post?
I'm with you, what you're saying.
I still have, you know, we all of us from IAA went and visited some of these offices 2-3 years ago, and all of us got various things. Like, I still remember Google gave us one of those pads, right? What is it called? Asus pad, what is it called? It's like
Google gave away.
Yeah, Google wala kuch pad hai, kuch, huh? Kuch diya tha. It's still lying around, you know. Yeah. So you guys have to start asking them for money.
Which is
don't settle for freebies. Ask for the green stuff.
You,
they've got a lot of the green stuff.
You
been to their office? Have you been to their bloody, you know, where they have food?
Have you been to their buffet?
Yeah, you went to the buffet. They've got a Telugu counter, a Tamil counter, a Kannada counter. Can you imagine?
I'll tell you what. So Google is like the mothership, right? Because we work so closely with YouTube and Google is more like the boss. I feel like that was a very smart way, in my opinion, to sort of not tell a creator what to do. Like, hey, you know what? We would really like it if you like share pictures saying hashtag Team Pixel. No, instead they made it a party and they made it look like, hey, you know what? Welcome to the group. It's all chill here. We don't expect
Pixel
anything
from a
you.
Pixel phone, by the way.
Sorry?
Pixel from a Pixel phone, not any other phone. Remember?
Well, that's, so. Yeah, obviously.
No, but there have been multiple instances where some other phone, influencers have been tweeting from some other phone and promoting
some
other brand.
Well, we always have a few of those cracked ones, yeah.
That was a big, what you're saying is right. There was a big, they had a big disaster when Oprah posted that she is going to give away some 100 of those, Microsoft phones. To people who participated in something, and the tweet came from an Apple iPhone.
It was
one of the most embarrassing, influencer marketing, issues. So next time you tweet something about Pixel, just make sure you're doing it from Pixel.
Oh no, don't worry about it. I have all of that figured out, but
Oprah didn't.
Too bad for her. No, but I would really like to finish what I was saying, though.
Please.
So there is a relationship. Like you say, it's a marriage. It's not a one-night stand, right? Where I know that if Google is being nice to me, Google is not telling me deliverables. Google is not telling me, hey, you know what? Do this. Instead, Google is making me part of a family and sort of making it look like, let's do this together. And it's a very organic placement.
I think Google is an exception because, yeah. I mean, especially for the influencers who work with YouTube, because it's more like a family where they are also helping to grow them.
So in India, it's really YouTube, right? Is there any other video platform?
IGTV.
Anywhere comparable?
IGTV. Not yet that big, but why not?
There are people who are very active on Facebook.
Facebook
has now started investing a lot into working closely with creators.
TikTok a platform?
Sorry?
Is TikTok a platform?
Tier 2, absolutely, yes.
Okay, so you please complete what you have to
say. I think, yeah, that's all.
Okay,
that's
good.
About it.
So we move to Naushad. Naushad is going to tell us about Miss Malini. Okay.
Well, first of all, thank you for having me and for this conference. I think it's very important that we discuss these issues today. Miss Malini comes from a fairly unique perspective, I suppose, because my wife... my wife and our founder, Malini, is arguably one of the very first influencers at scale in India. To give you some context on that, around 2011, we had a massive, massive party. We took over half of Hard Rock Cafe. We had brand sponsors involved because we had reached 1,000 Twitter followers. So you think about that, and today we're talking about millions. So
this was when 5 years ago?
This was in 2011, so almost seven years ago. So that's just to demonstrate kind of how far things have changed and our perspective on that. Now, as a larger media company, we also run our own influencer campaigns on behalf of influencers, brands and influencers. So I think when we talk about influencer campaigns, it's very important to also understand the evolution of the internet and where we are today. Because the other perspective that I have, that I'm fortunate to have, is my school was the second school after Harvard to be inducted into Facebook. I had just graduated when it was opened up. And so I remember, I must be one of the very early users globally of the platform. And I remember when Facebook first launched, just how exciting it was. That finally, there's a way to stay in touch with your classmates. And then when they opened up to more schools, now you can be in touch with your friends in, across the country. And then when it expanded outside of schools and the whole world.
The suspense is killing me. Which school did you go to?
I went to Yale University.
Thank you.
Sorry about that. But the idea is, eventually it got to a point where this idea that you could be in touch and connected to every single person in this world was such an exciting proposition that it was a very different world back then. Today, if you fast forward, obviously a lot has gone wrong with that premise. And what you're seeing now is a lot of social media fatigue, which is especially prevalent amongst your younger audiences. And what you're seeing now is people retreating into sub-communities. So for example, I would bet that most of you here are in a number of WhatsApp groups that you can't even count right now how many you're in. As an example, I checked on my way over, I'm in 126 groups with just Malini alone. So you can imagine now what's happening, this kind of retreat into these sub-communities, and that's why influencers are so important. It's not because influencers can give you reach, as you rightly pointed out. It's because influencers can get you into these communities in a meaningful and real authentic way. And so that's where we see the most successful campaigns happening, is where we're able to tap into communities and, you know, reflecting everything the other panelists have said, making sure that's an authentic experience for the brand and for the community of users. So the second part of your question is an example of a successful campaign we did. You know, recently we did a campaign on behalf of Honor, the cell phone brand. The reason that went off so well is we did, I think there's about 30 or 40
Excuse
different...
me, what's the name of the brand?
Honor, the phone brand. Honor from Huawei. Okay. I believe it's Huawei, yeah. So what we did there is we got 30 different influencers on Instagram. The brief was very simple. They were trying to promote their camera, and the theme was red and purple, I believe. And the idea was get 30 very good photographers who are in the kind of technology lifestyle space to post a picture with that. The brand had the right to look at all those pictures before they were posted, but there was a very good marriage there between what the brand wanted and the trust between the influencer to actually execute on that promise. And so the campaign was done over a course of 3 days. It was a huge success because you were able to now tap into 30 different people's communities. Another small example I wanted to give on this is Miss Malini sponsors a women's football team. You may have heard of the Roots Premier League that happens in Bandra and St. Andrews. There are 9 girls on that team. I recently posted a picture where I wanted to tag all of them. These girls are all in their early 20s. Every single one of these girls has a private Instagram account. None of them are interested in being open to the world. It's all about their own little communities. So when you're dealing with that kind of an environment, influencers become critical to your marketing mix if you really want to speak, at least on the digital front, to these sub-communities.
Thank you. We now go to Gaurav. Yeah?
Shainik, yeah. So obviously...
Sorry, Shainik, sorry.
So I'm sure most of us has covered majority of points. I'd like to quickly point out a psychological perspective. Majority of browsing these days happens on phone. Okay, so I'm sure there'll be hundreds and thousands of young girls, maybe across tier 1, tier 2 cities, following say Prajakta, following Miss Malini. Over here, the best thing about a mobile phone is that it is a private browsing experience. Being a private browsing experience, I am free to see what I want to see, all right? So when I'm doing that, I'm kind of trusting the person, or I'm looking up to the person. So I'm, like I said, there'll be hundreds and thousands of young girls who would be looking up to, say, a Prajakta, right? So if that's happening, I'm sure if Prajakta is kind of speaking about a brand, they are rightly influenced by, you know, the person influencing. So that's one perspective, because it is a private browsing experience. I'm not being told in public. No one likes to be told anything in public, right? So that's one perspective. Second perspective is the fundamental of influencer marketing is trust. If I trust the influencer I'm following, I'll madly do whatever I need to do. And you know what happens a lot of times, so I'll not name the celebrity, but I'll name 3 brands which he endorsed in a period of 72 hours on Twitter. Right. This happened very recently.
In the same category.
Mobile phone category. Right. It is absolutely
one celebrity or multiple celebrities.
Single celebrity, one of the top superstars of Bollywood, endorsed 3 mobile brands in 72 hours. So he was on YouTube mastered for a brand. The same night, he was on a particular television hosting a game show. Spoke about another brand. Happens to be from the same parent company. And the next day, he spoke about Apple iPhone, right? Again on Twitter.
Well, you see, okay, I'll give it back to you. But there is a little bit of a conundrum here that, you know, as a celebrity, you go to events, and in those events, you know, you may be a celebrity endorsing Coke, but they may be, Kinley's Coke. Sorry, there may be Aquafina on the table. So what do you do? You're picking up Aquafina, and then you suddenly discover someone has taken a photograph and posted it on YouTube,
right?
Or Instagram or wherever. So there is that.
No, but you can speak about them on national television and speak about the features.
So he did that, or yep. She did that.
He did that.
Good. Okay. Good for him, and he got away with it.
Yeah. So all the 3 brands annoyed. Like, so what do you do? So you the influencer, the people who are being influenced by this particular celebrity, they get confused. What brand should I buy? Right. So that should never happen. So trust by an influencer should never be broken. Right. So that's another perspective.
But I think equally a responsibility of an influencer as well as a brand. So in this case, while the brands were at fault, but I think if I have to talk to that celebrity, probably he has messed up his career in working with brands.
Gurpreet, some of these Bollywood celebrities cannot go wrong.
Sorry?
These are guys, they cannot go wrong. They can do all this, but they'll still have people queuing up outside. But you're supposed to give me an example of a good influencer
Absolutely.
Marketing campaign
yes.
you know of.
So we recently, again, a brand which we worked on. So we work closely with Alt Balaji as a brand. These guys have been doing a lot of activities across OTT space. So a particular show of theirs, which is The Test Case, which was supposed to be a marquee show of theirs. Okay, there was a lot of hype about the show. What happened is, after the first episode was out, the show was called off for a few months. For almost about 9 months, every single milestone which the brand achieved, we used to get at least 10 to 15 people bashing the brand across social media. These guys would be like, you guys fooled us, there's no Test Case coming in, what's happening, and all of that. We took your subscription because of Test Case, and you just kind of posted the first episode. And then the show was about to be relaunched. And again, it was a show with Nimrit Kaur and some really nice directors and cast and crew. The agenda we had was to change the whole perspective of the online audience to be positive towards the show and stop the hatred. So what we did was we got the complete TV universe. Again, since it is Balaji Telefilms, we had an exposure to the complete TV universe. Each and every TV, so we had about 25 odd TV celebrities, which with almost, you know, each one of them having at least a million followers on Instagram, a million followers on Twitter. Each of them wore green and supported the show. Okay, the hashtag which we promoted was Women in Green. That is one of our most award-winning campaigns. Each of them spoke on why women should be a part of combat forces. And they supported the show. They launched, the whole activity was launched in a period of about 8 to 10 hours. We had complete celebrity universe speaking about the hashtag, wearing green, putting out videos. Right, and the whole perspective was changed. In that year, it became one of the most watched web series. And that's only because of the influencer marketing we did for that.
Oh, great. Thank you. So you know, I think, just to pick up a thread, and I want to come back to the panel. So you're saying influencer marketing works best when the influencer and the brand are closely connected in some form. So the influencer picks the brand as much as the brand picks the influencer, which is not the case in typical celebrity stuff. You know, you're handling a soap, so you look after which film star is available and go and sign up that film star. So I'm asking, this is a kind of a tough question, but celebrities have got away with endorsing all kinds of products and services, saying that, look, I don't make these products. You know, someone has paid me money, I've signed up, the quality is their problem, the delivery is their problem, if the flat doesn't get ready, it's not my problem, if the car doesn't give you 25 kilometers per liter, that's not my problem. Now, are we on a slippery slope with the influencer thing? So the influencer has picked that car, and she's driving that car and saying it's a great car, and they say it gives 25 kilometers a liter. It doesn't. It gives 15. So can a consumer sue the influencer? Yeah, whoever wants to go.
So I think that's the first big difference. Influencer marketing is not brand endorsements. In a brand endorsement, you get somebody to be a part of your communication because you know that with that person in the communication, this communication will generically fly as well. However, you still end up putting a lot of media might on it, which is targeted to your TG, not to the brand endorser's TG. In influencer marketing, it's the exact reverse. The influencer has built their audience. You are now piggybacking on their audience to say a message out. In such cases, the biggest difference in metrics, and I think that's where the biggest challenge begins, as to how can you hold someone responsible for what? The product or the service itself is a different scope, and that remains common whether it's endorsement or influence. What's very important is, what's your metric? Is your metric awareness? Because then, yes, use the biggest celebrity, and taking your example, all those three brands have got high degree of awareness because an A-lister has mentioned them. The metric that influencer marketing needs to focus on is preference. And it's literally the age-old cycle of advertising.
So what metric do I use?
Preference, which is where you start saying, whatever I'm doing right now, in a crowded ecosystem of mobile phones, did this influencer make it easier for a consumer to choose me? And we all know this, the way advertising and communication is going, people don't buy products. People buy philosophies. People don't buy a shoe. People buy the ability to be their best version with Nike. And I think that's what an influencer easily does to your brand, because he or she has built a community.
No, but you know, finally, a CMO is answerable to a CFO, right? The CFO is going to ask, you spent X, you know, crores on your influencer marketing program. Sure. You signed up, you know, whatever, Miss Malini, Project, et cetera, to do something for you, right? Whether it was a new dress, a new shoe, or new specs, or whatever it is. How do you finally tell the CFO that these are the metrics I started with and I've delivered on these metrics?
So a lot of brands do this nowadays. They have unique preference codes given out to specific influencers who are highly engaged with them, saying use this code to this service and you will get something special. That's just a little tag on for them to check, did this influencer's task actually get served down my selling funnel? Exactly the CFO's question. Yeah, anything you do.
A lot of these brands are also using now social listening tools. So when they activate a campaign, they go through, is there have been any surge in the search, or people have been started talking about their brand in comments or in their posts regularly. So I think...
So you think brands have today figured out that I will, if I'm spending X crores on influencer marketing, I can track it?
Not, I don't think entirely.
Not completely.
And this is the issue I'm coming to, you know, which is worrying me, which is, it is still spray and pray. It's just spray and pray, something works. But are we moving towards, you know, slightly, and you're from Yale, so maybe you can, you know, throw some light, us plebeians are not able to figure out. How do you stop this business of praying and praying?
Well, I wouldn't quite put it that way, but thank you for the praise. I think, and as a practical piece of advice, what's important here is you're right, that there is a way of doing influencer marketing that is spray and pray. And here I'm referring to, you know, you'll see a lot of platforms now that promise to match you with a database of millions of influencers and find some way to connect you to the right brand. Now, that might be the first step, but really, if for those who've done influencer marketing, who are influencers or agencies, who they understand that each individual influencer, as we said, is their own community and needs to be worked with individually to make sure that it's done in a way that's suitable to their audiences and their platforms. So therefore, the way to reduce spray and pray is to work with partners who actually have a one-on-one or an actual relationship with these influencers, as opposed to just having a ranking of engagement and other numbers. That's the first practical advice. Secondly, yes, there is a tendency to consider influencer marketing spray and pray, but I would argue that your hoarding on the side of a highway, your advertisement in the middle of TV channels where there's no back and forth, where there's no engagement, where there's no understanding of the effectiveness, aside from how many cars drive by here and what is the typical profile of the person driving by. So I think it's a little unfair to characterize influencer marketing as spray and pray, because first of all, you're working with known individuals. Those individuals have communities that are digitally connected to them that give you data such as engagement, comments. There are tools now you can use to measure what, not only how many people are talking about you, but what is the general tone of how they're speaking about you, the lift in your brand's reputation online. So there's many ways you can be smart about it. I think your point is correct that a lot of brands have kind of skipped that step and are going to these platforms where they put in a certain amount of money and they hope to get something out of it. There is a place for that kind of marketing. It's called Facebook, it's called Google Ads, where you're trying to spray and pray and seeing conversions on that. And there's nothing wrong with that. But the beauty of influencer marketing is that it is much more personal, or at least it gives you the opportunity to get much more personal with your marketing. And there, I think you do see you know, more concrete results than if you're just spraying and praying.
So good. So we'll come to the last question, and then we can wind up. I'm told there are three types of content. The hero content, which is a big budget thing, jumping from the moon or jumping from the sky. The second is what is called engaging content, which is like a serial. And the third is called the, I'm told it's called the helpful content, you know, how to make whatever, Milkmaid, whatever, how to make various stuff. What of these three works best when mixed with the influencer?
I don't think there is any blueprint for that this is something which will work. It entirely depends on which is the influencer you're working with and Are you looking at a short-term goal, or are you looking at building a long-term community with that? For example, what Bacardi has been able to do with Nuclear, as a brand where they have signed up together that we'll build a community together over a period of years, is a very good case study where it's not a short-term goal that let's create overnight hero content, but we'll work together over a period of years where someday Bacardi and Nuclear will become a similar brand out there. I think there are, so I don't think there is one such example which I can give it to you that this is the right approach and follow the hero content. For some people, hero content works. I mean, we also work with people like Badshah and Raftar. For them, at times, hero content works where a brand wants a certain spike in their traffic on their website or on their e-commerce portals over a period of 48 hours. But then there are brands who want to engage conversations with communities over a period of longer time, which actually gives them a much more trust and loyalty working with brands and influencers. So at times, that's a better approach.
Prajukta, any particular preference for you or you?
Not really. For me, it really is a week-to-week struggle of writing whatever is relatable to me as a creator and to my audience. I put out 3 videos every week, and all 3 are very different from each other. You speak about engaging. I feel like a lot of my Saturday videos are super engaging because those are basically Q&A videos. My Tuesday videos are more candid. That includes a lot of how to talk to the camera, sort of chill story time videos, travel vlogs, more candid. And my Thursday videos are what drives the channel majorly, which is the well-produced, well-written comedy content. So I don't think we ever sit down. I've not even thought of it with as being 3 different types of content.
I read it recently in a book. The category is a hero, hygiene, and help. The 3 types of content.
I can add some perspective there as well, very quickly. For us, the most successful campaigns are the ones where you have a good blend of these different kinds of videos. We wouldn't also define them in those 3 categories, but we look at your category A, B, and C influencers and who brings what to the table. So I think, as with any marketing, the most effective ones tend to be where you're using a good bouquet of those. And that includes, by the way, digital and non-digital. So some digital, some TV. There was a panel, I think, earlier about how those two interact. I think that's very critical to your marketing mix to have a healthy mix of all that.
So with that, I think our time is up. So thank you. Let me thank the panel for an engaging discussion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your patient listening.